peanut butter back home, isn't it, Shane? They had bread and peanut butter that back home.
Yeah. I think that's all the announcements I have. So let's all stand. Let's welcome one another to our service and then to prepare for our Sunday night.
Continue to make us faithful and strong, our Father, and just work in our lives and all the lives here tonight. And if there's one among us that's not saved, our Father, we just ask that you stir in their heart and mind until they get it settled before it's eternally too late, our Father. And we just pray that you'll allow us to use this offering for the uplifting of our kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
assurance number 321. Nothing between. Let's stand and sing number 321.
The Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies are over all his works, and all thy works shall praise thee. Psalms 145:9-10. We love him because we fools loved him. All things were made by him, without him was not anything made that was made. Evening and morning at noon, I'll play quite loud.
Tonight with our spiritual gifts lessons that we've been going through, and we're coming up on the teacher. Now, if you have not taken the spiritual gifts test, let me know. I didn't look back in the vestry to see if there are any other tests back there. But you can take one of those. I encourage you to take one because it's important for you to know what your particular spiritual gift is. That way you can communicate to other people. And then as we go through these things and people know what your spiritual gift is, you'll understand yourself a little bit better. But two, you'll be able to understand each other a little bit better. And it helps us to know where people are coming from, you know, how God uses them. Because all of these gifts have their own strengths. But they also have their own weaknesses. And so what we need to do is work on our weaknesses. Don't be surprised if you have all the weaknesses. That's pretty common. Just work on those. And then those of us who don't have a particular spiritual gift, our job is not just to blow it off. Our job is to work on the characteristics. Because if we're supposed to be like Jesus, he had all of the spiritual gifts. And we're supposed to have these things in our life as well. So we need to work on all of these things. But we'll pick up with that as the Lord leads here. It won't be next week, but maybe the week after that. The Lord led me to something else this afternoon that I'm going to cover. But let's have a word of testimony time. We had our young people just come back from camp, and I thought they were all going to skip out on me at first. I was like, man, they're not even here, and we're going to have testimony time tonight. I thought, well, we'll just have testimony time again next week. So we'll just keep. I shouldn't have announced it this morning. But anyway, I'm glad that they're here. I would like them, if they would want to testify, maybe something that happened at camp that was a special blessing, and maybe something the Lord dealt with you about, or if you want to share that, that's fine. But an adult can stand up and testify as well. So let's give you an opportunity for some testimony time. Yep, Chad.
So this year I went to camp. I knew I needed to make a couple decisions. But like usual, the flesh tried to fight back. But on Wednesday night, I went forward and I made a commitment to honor my parents no matter the circumstances. But I had a friend at camp, and all through the week, his name's Colin, and all through the week, I didn't feel right about him. I felt like he wasn't saved on a Friday night even before he did save.
Amen. Praise the Lord. So if you didn't hear that guy that he was concerned about at camp, he went forward Friday night. I don't know how many decisions there were this week. Didn't they remember?
There were seven salvation decisions.
Seven salvation decisions. Praise the Lord for that. And that's wonderful. Anybody else? Yep, Andrew.
I've been going to camp for 4 years now, not counting 2020. But it's always been a blessing every year, and I've made friends there, and I've made countless decisions there, and it's really helped me through my walk with the Lord. And I had a couple of friends get saved there too, Colin and a kid named Damien, very close friends of mine there. But I'd like to thank you all for praying for us, and that really means a lot. And I know that you were praying, and I hope that you'll pray next week for junior camp, as some of us will be counseling and some of these kids will be going, and I pray that you'll help the children that are there, that you'll help them with their salvation decisions and any decisions that they need to make for the Lord.
Amen. Yeah, that's great. Yeah, we have six going next week for counselors. Of course, Andrea's going one, and Nathaniel, see if I remember everybody, Caleb, Scott, Chad, and Andrew are all going as counselors here for next week, and they needed some help, and I'm glad they were able to do that. So you really need to pray for those kids. I guarantee the counselors will enjoy themselves. And it's a different age group, a different mindset, but they'll still have a blast. I know they'll have fun. And if any of you have never been a counselor at camp, you don't always just with the kids all the time. I mean, sometimes you're helping out in the kitchen, sometimes you're doing other things. And you can say, hey, I would just like to help out in this area. And they would be tickled to death to be able to do that. So if you'd like to give some time and help out with camp, I think it'd be a blessing to you. But I guarantee you'll come back changed. And you know, as we pray for those young people last week, and we can start praying for the juniors, the certain one, don't quit praying for the teenagers. And just because they come back, because really, this is where the battle begins. I mean, if you've ever gone to camp, ever taken young people to camp, there's a lot of decisions made through the week. And sometimes you know, the worst enemy, unfortunately, are church family and family members. They throw water on the fire in a hurry, and we don't want to do that. We want them, we want to encourage them, you know, to continue on with their decisions. And even if you don't know what the decisions are, just pray that, that God will continue to work in their life with those decisions they've made for Him. And I believe that will honor God, and it will help strengthen them. So pray for those juniors as well when they make decisions. So anybody else, word of testimony?
Well, it was a great week of camp. We had a lot of fun. But one thing the Lord really spoke to me about this week, I think it was Wednesday, Preacher Matt Fine was speaking of the message was entitled The War Within. But there was one thing in the message he mentioned, it was about the little things and how the little things are what make the big things. And he used to quote from D.L. Moody, if I can remember, it's like everybody is ready to do the big things, but few are willing to do the small things and the little things. And that's, it just really spoke to me because, you know, I believe God's called me into the ministry. I've been that for 7 years now, but I have not been doing the little things here lately. And if I'm not doing the little things, then God can't, God would not be able to trust me with the big things. So that's just something that really spoke to me this week. And I hope that you all will help me pray that I can do little things and just to help everybody else pray for their commitments.
Amen. Praise the Lord for that. And you know, it is the little things are what it's what's going to make or break it. You know, the Bible says it's little foxes that spoil the vine. So little decisions, either against the Lord or for the Lord, go a long way. And we all can take the challenge as far. Matter of fact, I'm going to touch a little bit on the little things here tonight. So anybody else? It was great. Yes, Dan.
I got a prayer real quick, sir.
Yep.
My mom been dead 9 years, 15, this month. And me and my brother spoke together on that day. Father, you pray for us.
Yeah. Amen. Pray for them. Pray for Danny and his brother, the Lord will, and God can work it out, put them back together. And, yeah, sometimes it is even little things, little misunderstandings. Sometimes it gets in the way of things. But yeah, I believe God here to answer that prayer. Anybody else?
I was getting a little overwhelmed. I guess it was either last week or the week before, just with all the stuff that you see on the news. Sometimes I don't watch the news a lot, but you still see it on social media. And knowing the history, just in general history of the world, it gets me in my emotions just because I know where this is going to head to if something doesn't happen. So I was getting really worked up about it, and I was doing my new Bible reading, and I came across the verse that said that the powers of be are ordained of God.
Yeah.
And it would just give me peace. And I was just like, thank you, God. I'm glad that I read that.
Yeah. Amen. And that's something we forget. The powers of be are ordained of God. And they didn't catch him by surprise. You know, God's got a plan and purpose. And you know, when people, it's not so much the leaders that we're waiting on, the godly leaders. I believe what God's waiting on are for his people. And when his people, what we're supposed to do, he gives us the leaders he wants us to have. And that's just the way it works. So that's encouraging. You know, Jeff?
Yeah, of course, we just got back from vacation, but probably you guys heard me preach on, but I feel like God's given me building my faith every year. We go on vacation, I could go to, I got bee stung and about died. Micah got a hook in his eye. And I mean, it's like every year God's just showing, you know, and it's just literally people's passed away. I mean, it got to the point where it was like, it became a joke. So a couple of weeks ago, God started speaking to me, you know, to start praying about it. And you know, I think you had continually kept saying, you know, the safety of the Lord shouldn't be taken for granted. And I'm thinking, you know, here it's coming up. It almost gets to the point where it's like, what's going to happen this year that God's going to build my faith with? So I started praying and said, you know, Lord, just help us to have a safe week. And nothing happened while we're there. And I know that you can do that. And anyway, and so, you know, this year, I guess my faith was is that God answered every bit of that. There was nothing happened. We got, me and Aaron had a couple of close calls traveling down. Of course, we'd prayed for traveling mercies and it was just, I mean, as we were coming back, there was a tractor trailer had come over on us and we were in the bully washer, and I was
boating truck half in the media, and he finally seen me, and I don't really know how we got out of the middle of it. But I told him, it's like, you know, the miracle of that is we come back down 220, there was no ditches, there was no signs, there was no guardrails, there was nothing in that stretch of the road, but a bunch of that area has that. And I said, you know, if that would have happened anywhere else up through here, I wouldn't have had the option to ease over. We would have just been trapped in there. So I just want to praise God for, you know, as a couple of weeks ago I started to pray for that this week would be as safe and that nobody would have to go through any of that. And we made it all the way through the week with nothing.
Amen. Happened. Praise the Lord. Yeah, if you ever go on vacation with Jared, be prayed up. Michael.
And for, I mean, and I go and say that for many of you don't know, last year, Micah, a hook swung out, and it was a big hook, and it got and hit him right in the eyeball. And the lure was about that long, and it was hanging there. And of course, and Micah's screaming, and Aaron loses her nursing ability at this point. And I'm going, you know, stabilize the lure, stabilize the lure. And of course, it's a lot easier to say that when I'm trying to idle in. And so we called back to the dock, and this thing just, as Aaron was praying, and they said, as soon as they seen us around the corner, my brother said, Mike said, you know, I just finished praying and said amen, and the lure literally just fell out. Somehow, didn't get in his eyeball, and this, I mean, I should bring the lure and show you, but it's a huge hook on it. Somehow made it between the eyeball and the eyelid, and then just fell out with no barbs catching or nothing. Wow. And so, well, no, it was of the Lord.
Yeah. Amen.
That's awesome.
Anybody else? Yep, see.
I don't know if y'all have heard the story. It's kind of funny. I pray for my wife quite regularly. Well, every day. And the preacher's actually going to pray for him. But anyway, it's been several years back. She was really stressed at work. And I prayed that she would get some time off and have some time just to recuperate. And she fell off the chair and broke her foot. Well, during COVID, and I don't know, I've told the preacher this, I was praying for when we should get started coming back to church regular and all this, and that Sunday's when we had a COVID outbreak in the church. So, we have both been struggling with losing weight. So back earlier in the year, I started praying for us to lose weight, and she got diabetes. And we have lost our weight. Where I'm going with this is, we think it's funny, and it doesn't sound like a lot, but those are answered prayers, and we should be thankful no matter how God answers them or his timing. They're still answered prayers.
Yeah.
If he answered all our prayers the way we wanted him to answer them, we'd be in a worse mess than we are.
Yeah.
And I just, you know, I'm just thankful that he answers our prayers no matter whether we think it's the right way or not.
Yeah, and that's why I'm a firm believer specific prayers. In specific prayers. And it's true. And we pray generally, and then we don't even realize, like Steve said, those were answered prayers, and all those things happened, but it wasn't maybe what was planned and the way they thought would happen. And that happens to us so often in the Christian life. And so we pray specifically, and God answers specifically as well.
Yeah.
That was great. Anybody else?
Jimmy. I wasn't able to go to camp this year as a counselor. And it was funny because as soon as I pulled in up there, remember I pulled in the van, I opened the door, and the kids started coming in and was like, everybody was wondering where you was at this week. Everybody wanted, you know. So I wasn't able to make it this week. But I do want to tell something to these kids going back as counselors in a couple weeks. When you're at camp, I call them a teeter totter. Monday and Tuesday, the kids are all uptight. They're not, you know, they're not comfortable with each other yet. They're in a new environment. They just had to give up their phone. You know, they're all out of sorts. Wednesday for the campers is a turning point usually because they're getting into the groove. They're enjoying being around each other. They don't understand it, but being without their device for a couple of days allows them to communicate with people. But anyway, on Wednesday, usually is when the chapel times start getting more active. The kids start coming forward, and the more decisions start being made. But it's also a turning point for counselors. This is what I want to tell you guys is going for counselors. Wednesday is a turning point for counselors because on Thursday and Friday you get tired.
Yeah.
And you're dealing with kids. Kids are excited on Thursday and Friday because Wednesday they rank up and the counselors dwindle back. So as we were talking earlier about the little things, you guys as counselors can either make or break week camp for these kids. Be on your attitude and be careful how you treat the kids, because whether they come back next year can depend on how you treat them while you're there.
That's right.
And don't leave it all up to the man that's giving the messages every evening. It's those counselors and those team leaders that's with them kids all day, every day, for 5 days.
That's right.
That make the biggest impact on them kids. So remember that as you get tired of the week, pray the Lord give you strength and be a good testimony and help those kids have fun the whole week.
Yeah, I think that's excellent advice. Even as we were talking to the kids when they came back yesterday and hearing how everything went, I can't tell you how many times counselors' names came up in the conversation. Mm-hmm. You have more of an impact than you think you're having. And they're watching those little things. They're watching the stuff like that. So that's good advice. Roger, you have your hand up?
Yeah, I just want to thank you for saving my soul. I want to thank you for health and strength. I thank you very, very many times every day. And I'm thankful for my church and all my friends. Thank you for saving my faith.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Anybody else? Good. Just to give you another chance here, but think about campers, and when Caleb said this, it reminded me, Brother Matt Bryan, it was, I don't remember how many years ago now, but he actually surrendered the call to preach at camp.
Yep.
And of course, we supported him as he started a church in Petersburg, West Virginia, and the church is going strong, doing a great job, and you know, God's used in a great way. And you never know, like we've talked about Cold Wars, you know, some churches do Vacation Bible School, that is our Vacation Bible School's Cold Wars. Things like this in kids' lives make a big difference. I was saved at a Vacation Bible School. Some of you have been saved at Vacation Bible School. Some of you were saved at Cold Wars. And so those things make a big difference. So I appreciate everybody who has a part in those things. Anybody else word testimony? Those are all his family.
Well, a few years ago, a while back, I went to visit our old family, and I was trying to invite my parents to go to church with me, and they kept on putting it off, and they're into different things. My name is Jesus. I was praying for them over 16 years now. And
we're
praying that they would get saved before it's too late.
Yeah, amen. Yeah, we don't pray for our lost family members, who will. So pray for her lost family members. Anybody else? No? Okay, well, take your Bibles and turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 16. Be in prayer this week for Marietta Lambert. She goes to have surgery Thursday. We have a couple others that are going to have some doc appointments this week we'll be praying for. 1 Corinthians chapter 16. This is a small verse in the Bible. I have never heard a message preached from this verse or even any verse like it. And this was the verse the Lord led me to. And in a way, it's kind of humorous, but with what I'm going to talk about tonight, I'm just going to be real brief. It's going to kind of just be a family chat. I think most of us in here are part of our church family. I don't see them, but it's not. Either you've been coming for a while or you're very familiar with the church here. But I want to be careful with my wording. And please don't read into any more than what I say, because I don't drop hints at all. But I just want us to be more aware of things. I think we have an absolutely wonderful church here.
Amen.
I'm just tickled to death to be your pastor. and have a part in all of this. And but I believe with all my heart, God wants more. I believe that. And He wants more from me. He wants more from you. So there are things that we can always improve on, and that's what we have to do, or look for areas where we can improve in. And I just don't want you to think with this message, because I know it may come off this way, these are not things I'm complaining about at all. But these are just things that we need to be noticing. I think our church has an extremely, I think we are, we have a very friendly church. But the thing I want us to see, and hopefully God will help us to do that, sometimes it's hard putting ourselves in other people's shoes and seeing things from their perspective. That's difficult to do sometimes. Some people can do it easier than others. What I'm going to ask you to do is put yourself in the shoes of a visitor or of maybe somebody that's part of our church family but hasn't been here for a long, long time. And then they come back in. And put yourself in their shoes. How are they going to perceive things? We're going to talk a little bit about some of that stuff here tonight. And this is one verse, and you'll see why you're going to chuckle here a little bit when I get it to you. It's verse number 20. 1 Corinthians 16 and verse 20. All the brethren greet you. Greet you one another with a holy kiss. A little different, isn't it? Let's pray. Father, we ask you to guide and direct our thoughts together now, and I pray that you will help us, Lord, as we have seen you do great things in our midst, Lord. We've seen you speak to hearts and challenge us. And Lord, we've stepped up to the challenge many times. We've seen lives change, souls saved. And Lord, we want to continue to do that. But I believe with all my heart, there are greater things still in store for our church and what you want us to do, not just only in our own community, but Lord, in the communities around us. And Lord, as we even try to reach the uttermost part of the earth. And Father, I just pray that we will just hear for the next few minutes, that we'll have ears to hear. And Lord, help us to see where we ourselves as an individual can maybe improve in one area. And if you show us a couple areas, that would be great. But Lord, we just ask you to be honored and glorified now through all this. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Can you remember what you felt like the first time that you went to church? Maybe the first time you came here. Maybe the first time you'd gone to another church. Do you remember what you felt like? Remember what you were thinking? I remember what I was thinking when I started going to church. And there's a verse in the Bible, and I want you to hold your place here because there's only one other verse I want you to turn to. Turn to Proverbs chapter 18. So these two verses here. Proverbs chapter 18. And verse number 24. I've entitled this message, No Visitors Allowed. Now, the reason I entitled it that way is because that's the way some people feel when they come into a church. And unfortunately, we've had some feel that way coming into our church. And again, I think we have a wonderful church. I think we're very friendly. But is there anything that maybe we have done unintentionally that has communicated that message to somebody? These are things we have to examine. So I've entitled it, No Visitors Allowed. Proverbs 18:24, look what it says here. It says, A man that hath friends must show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Now this verse is very important for you to see. It says a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. Sometimes we always want people coming up to us and talking to us and making us feel welcome. And the only way that's going to happen is when we show ourselves friendly to other people. And there's a lot of ways we can show ourselves friendly. And then the Bible says there is a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Of course, that's speaking there of the Lord Jesus Christ. But as we apply this verse to our own life, when a visitor comes in, somebody comes in, maybe they don't have a friend here,
They're a stranger off the street. We might have seen them in the community. We come in, we notice somebody's different. Oh, I don't know who that person is. And they come in and they sit in the church. Now, let me say this. Our men in the back, our people in the back, do a wonderful job welcoming people as they come through the door. But it's more than that. People come in, they sit down, and then there may not be another word said to them until the handshaking time. And sometimes that's an awkward time for a visitor, and we'll get into that here in just a second. But we want to make sure we show ourselves friendly. And sometimes it's just like, you know, hey, you mind if I sit here next to you? Now you might be, and this is going might knock some of you out of your comfort zone, your seat may be on the other side of the church. But it's okay to sit in a different spot. And I know some of you do that. I see you shuffling around. I'm glad you're not. One thing we ought to never happen in this church, never have happened in this church, and it has happened more than it needs to happen in churches. We ought to never have somebody come in and tell a visitor, hey, you're sitting in my spot. That visitor, I guarantee, will never come back to that church. That's a wrong thing because you don't have a spot. We don't pay for these pews to rent our spot in a pew. Now, if we did that, that might be different. You're paying a couple hundred dollars a week to rent that spot, then yes, somebody can get out of your spot. And until we do that, though, you don't have a spot. And if we have to, if it gets so crowded in here and you don't sing in the choir, well, maybe that's a good time for you to start joining the choir. Just come up and have a seat up here in the choir if we have to do that. You know, whatever we have to do, we want people to feel comfortable. So let me just go through some things here. We want visitors, obviously, to come to church, and we want them to stay. So here's the challenge. Why won't some people stick when they come to church? Now, these are just some things that people have come across over the years. So I just want to get into you here quickly. First of all, one reason people don't stay. Some of these things will apply to us, some of them won't. There's an awkward stand and greet time in the service. This is where we stand and say, let's all stand, welcome one another to the service. Some people find that awkward if they don't know anybody and then nobody comes up and shakes their hand. Or maybe you realize there's one visitor here and they get 50 people come over and it's like, hi, it's good to have you here. Hi, it's good to have you here. And you're going way overboard to make them feel welcome. To a visitor, that comes off almost weird. There's like 1,000 people that came over here to shake my hand. So you have to be alert with what's going on. You see a couple people over there maybe talking to a visitor, shaking their hand, welcome to the service. Then that might not be the best time for you to go over as well and try to make it a point to shake their hand. Maybe wait until there's some downtime, and then you can maybe talk to them after the service and just you tell them you're glad they came. It might be something brief. Then they come the second time. That might be a time to get to know them a little bit more. But you don't always have to just say, hey, glad to have you here for service. Sometimes you can just, you know, smile at them. You know, like, hey, how you doing? You know, that type of thing. So an awkward standing greet time is one reason. Matter of fact, that's another one reason people don't come back to church. Number two, unfriendly church members. Now, can you believe that? Unfriendly church members? There are unfriendly church members? Well, let me tell you what some people think unfriendly church members are. The people aren't talked to once they're seated. They're greeted when they come through the door, but once they're seated, nobody talks to them. A visitor looks at it like it's an unfriendly church. We have to be careful of that. So it's all of our responsibilities, because that verse we read from 1 Corinthians 16:20, it says, all the brethren greet thee. It's all of our jobs. Some people consider being unfriendly when members tend to only stick to their friends. You know, sometimes we say there's little cliques, you know, and all that. And you might not think of yourself as having a clique. I'm sure there are people in this church you don't know. Okay? That's probably the case. Get to know them. This is how we practice becoming friendly to other people. When there's a stranger that comes into the church, maybe they were a member of this church years ago and they moved away and now they're coming back to the church. And you've seen them before, and to you it's just kind of like, okay, they're coming home. Still make it a point to tell them you're glad to see them. Still make it a point to make them feel welcome. Because they might be going through a difficult time, and there might be something else going on in their life, and by nobody talking to them, they may not understand that we're just all naturally in love with them and just so happy to see them. They may not understand that. They may feel shunned because nobody says anything to them. You see, we have to take these things upon ourselves. But that's how people can tend to be unfriendly at church. Another reason that people may not come back to church is in unsafe or unclean children's areas. We ought to never expect young families to stay in church if this particular area isn't met. I know we've visited many churches over the years. We'd be traveling, we'd visit churches. These are things we look for. Is the nursery safe? Do we know where our kids are going to be? Who's teaching our kids? Are the kids ever going to be unsupervised? Now, if you work with kids, you're teaching Sunday school, or you're working on a Wednesday night class, this is why it's important for you to be in your place when you're supposed to be there. Kids start coming and they're in a spot unsupervised, and then a visitor comes in with some children and they see that, that is not a good testimony. They may not understand the reason the worker's late, but we need to go above and beyond to make sure that we're doing everything we can to make sure we're in our place when people show up, because we don't know when God may be sending somebody our way. And we need to make that a good first impression. Always put yourself in other people's shoes. Let me move on here. The next thing, reason people don't stay in church. Now, this doesn't really apply to us necessarily. There's no place to get information from the church. Some churches have an information booth out in front. We don't have that necessarily. But what we do have is a gospel tract. Whenever we hand out a visitor's card, this is a good thing to hand to people as well, especially visitors. You know, hey, if you'd like to come to our services, this tells our service times. And another thing, the reason people don't come back to church is because their webpage. Now, we don't have a webpage, but their webpage is extremely confusing. The two most important things visitors look for on a webpage when they look for a church is when are the services and what's the address. They're both on here. So this is why it's good for us to get. We don't have information booths or anything like that, but that's a good thing for us to hand out. So if you're an usher or somebody in the back and you're handing somebody, if you see somebody come in that needs a visitor card, go ahead and hand them a gospel tract as well and just point that out to them so they'll have that information. Let's see. I covered that one already. Another reason people don't come back to church are boring or bad church services. Now, this is more on me, but you know, something that I can use help in, and I'm always looking for help, but it's never a good idea for a pastor to get up and do everything in the service. If I came up here and I led the singing, and then I led the choir, and then I did the announcements, and then I did the prayer, you guys would get sick of hearing me in a very short period of time. And visitors do as well. But something that keeps the services interesting is having more people get involved. You know, if I sang the special and just did it all, you know, just like a one-man show, that's not good. That's not good. Now, I don't do that. I'm thankful we have people who do things. You know, Roger leads the choir, Jody leads the singing. We have others that, you know, led the singing before. You know, different people would sing specials. Those are good things. I would love for somebody to do the announcements. But doing announcements and welcoming people to the service is not just reading a bulletin. You know, it's trying to make sure that people understand. It's trying to keep them connected with what's going on and making them feel a part of what's there. And I can do a better job at that, but we all can at least pray in that direction. But we don't want to have boring or bad church services. This is why I always need to prepare and pray for messages and try to study to make sure that I'm feeding the flock of God when they come. Another reason that people may not come back to church is... And I touched this one already. Members telling people that they're in the wrong pew. That's not a good thing. Here's another one. This is a good one. Dirty facilities. This can keep people from coming back to church. Now, I'm thankful that Julie does an excellent job cleaning the church here. And I'm glad we have somebody, and I'm glad that we pay somebody to do that. Because that's a full-time job. That's a lot of cleaning. We have a lot of property that needs done. But think about this. Think about not just the cleaning. Think about our property as a whole. Does the property say, we really just don't care? Does it say that? Or is it very welcoming? Let me ask you an example, or give you an example. Whose responsibility is it for the flower beds out front? Anybody know? Well, I know we're all going to say everybody. But if it's everybody, then who does it? Nobody. You see? That's the way it works. Now, we've had some people volunteer. One other thing, and I just noticed this the other day because I came through that door up there. Our siding on this side of the church, every year, I mean, it just gets inundated with spider droppings everywhere. I mean, it looks horrible. And I'm glad we have people from time to time say, hey, I want to come up and pressure wash, you know, the church. But whose job is it? It is everybody's. But you know what we can use? Somebody to say, hey, I'll take that ministry. And make sure the spider webs are taken down. I mean, you can spray lily stuff on the siding or whatever you want. Or something, lavender, I think it is. You spray a lavender scent will keep spiders away. There's little things we can do. We can even have it, you know, taken care of professionally if we have to. But there's little things that can be done. Doing the flower beds, doing other things like that. Somebody, there, that's what I've mentioned many times. There is something for everybody to do in the church. You know, whose job is it to mow the lawn? I know Rodney mows the lawn, but that's not his job. That's what he does. He does it for a ministry. Sometimes other people help him. They do it for a ministry. The weed eating. We have some guys who come and do the weed eating. And that helps out tremendously. And there's so many things that go on in the church. The maintenance. God has blessed this church with a lot of property, a lot of this stuff. And I'm not complaining at all. I'm just saying somebody can take ownership and say, hey, I'll do that. We've had that happen in other ministries of the church. I can tell you what they are, but I don't want to embarrass the people. I know they do it for the Lord. And what they do, they're doing for God. And they said, hey, I'm just going to take care of this particular ministry. And that's what we need to do. We all need to find something that we can do and say, hey, I'll take care of that for you. Marietta, speaking of Marietta, praying for her, she does the flowers out front. She tries to make sure that if flowers are here, you know, they look good. She helped fix the things up here. That was a ministry. She says, you know, I can't do much, but I can do that. That's what we need. It's stuff like that. And that is welcoming to visitors when they come to church. And again, I hope this doesn't come off at all like I'm complaining, because I'm not. These are just little things we need to be aware of from time to time. And we always need to try to do a little house cleaning with stuff like this. And two, when we think about not just the cleaning, but everything that we do in church, we ought to think about the details. The details, and some people are better at this than others. I can see some details, but the details go a long way. You know, what if we had a sign out here out front, and whoever's, you know, right now Rodney does the signs, but let's say everything he puts up there is spelled wrong. What does that say? Now, I'm thankful he checks it, and he double checks it, and triple checks it. He even asked me to check it, and he goes above and beyond to make sure everything's spelled right. And that's good, because that's the way it should be. Those are the details. And that's what we all need to be aware of, not just the details of that, but the details of everything. So, those are the challenges that we have. And you know, another challenge, that another reason people don't come back to church is because the church is too full. You believe that? You know, when the church gets too full, that's when we probably need to have, I mean, if we start getting packed here. I remember when we first came, we had chairs going to the side. But when we have services like that, we probably need to move the service to the activity building. Because some visitors come in, and guess what? They're not coming back. That makes them feel really uncomfortable because it's too full. Something else we can do, if we see the service is getting full, church is getting full, and there's a few empty spots up here, a good thing for us to do, and I know this is going to be a surprise, it would be a good idea for you just to up and move your stuff and come sit up here. Why? Because when a visitor comes in, if they come in late, guess what? They don't want to have to walk all the way up here in front of a bunch of strangers and sit up front. They'd like to just slip in the back, unnoticed. That's the way it should be. So we all need to be aware of little things like that. So what are the answers? Well, the answers are simple. We just need to make sure we're doing our part to care about the facilities. You know, that verse there, all the brethren greet you one another with a holy kiss. We need to make sure that we care about the facilities, that this church ought to look better than your house. You think about that.
Does it? If not, we need to put some more care and attention into it. Why? Because this is not God's house, but this is where we meet to worship the true and living God. So we need to make sure that we're taking care of it, because it is a representation of our Lord. Also, we all need to be friendly and do our part. Now, when visitors come in, and I need to just finish this here quickly. I don't have time. I want to get a volunteer up here and explain this. But we have a visitor come in. How do you make them feel welcome? Now, I'm talking to the young people, too. Young people. We get a new kid comes into the kids' class. Do you make them feel welcome? Do you go up and say, "Hi, my name's so-and-so. It's good to have you here. What's your name?" And start talking to them. These are things we all can do, young and old. Because what makes a little child, I'm praying that God's going to start us up these bus routes. I'd like to get these buses moving and get kids in here. But if we get some new kids come in and nobody makes them feel welcome, do you think they're going to want to come back? But all you have to do is just almost befriend them. He that hath friends must show himself friendly. Say, "Hi, how are you? I'm glad you're here. You want to sit with me? Why don't you go over here and sit?" And just start talking with them. Invite them into your group. And it's not just kids that need to do that. It's adults as well. Invite them into your group. And as we learn to talk to people, ask questions. You know, have you lived here in the area long? Do you have family? Do you have brothers and sisters? You know, your mom and dad? You know, just keep on asking questions and get them to talk a little bit about themselves. And that makes people feel more comfortable. And be a good listener as you're doing that. And this passage here that we left off on in 1 Corinthians 16:20, let me just close with this. It says, "All the brethren greet you." That all means it's everyone's job. It's all of our jobs. And I think we have a wonderful, friendly church here. I really do. But is there any area that we're lacking? And we can't let our guard down any service. Whether it's a Wednesday night, Sunday morning, Sunday school, we need to be vigilant. We need to be looking. Hey, is there somebody here that I don't know? And look for those visitors and then make it a point to go up and talk to them. Make it a point to make them feel welcome. That's what we need to do. So it's all our responsibility. And it says all, and the brethren greet you. That word greet is in there twice. That's just simply what we do. We greet them. And it says, "Greet you one another with a holy kiss." Now, we're not going to go up and give each other a holy kiss. But you know what that is talking about there? That's just showing somebody that you genuinely care. That's what that's meant. You're showing that you care. And that's what, I know that was what made me feel welcome. I probably never would have gone back to church again. I wouldn't be up here preaching to you today because God wouldn't have called me to preach because I wouldn't have been in church. I probably never would have done that if the church I went to was not so welcoming. And they didn't show me genuine love, but they were really glad that I was there. And I thought there was something funny going on. And so I went back again to see what it was that was so funny. It's like, you know, what's different about these people? Why are they so happy? Why are they so joyous and have so much peace in their life? And every time I went, the Lord spoke to my heart. And that's how we can influence other people, especially visitors when they come into church, because there are people who are hungry looking for the truth. We have the truth, and we need to do our part to try to make sure that we're creating an environment that is saying, "Hey, we want you to come," because that's what our Lord wants. He says, "Come unto me, all you labor and heavy laden." He's very welcoming, and we need to be doing the same thing. So let's all stand and we'll have a word of prayer. Father, we thank you so much for the scriptures, and I thank you for all the wonderful testimonies we heard just a little bit ago. And Lord, we're so glad at how you're working in our hearts and lives. And Lord, this is such a different kind of a message and a different verse, but yet it is scripture. It's something that you've given to us to learn from. And Lord, I'm glad we have a lot of things to be thankful for here in our church. We're blessed in a lot of ways, and I think we have some wonderful, wonderful folks. But Lord, there are always areas that we can improve in. The moment we let our guard down is the moment we may lose somebody. And Lord, everyone that comes in this church is important. And we want to make sure that we're doing our part to make that message communicated to them. Whether it's doing something with the facilities, whether it's actually talking to them individually, whatever we can do, whatever our part is, I pray that we all will take ownership of that. And we thank you, Lord, so much that you're willing to use us, and Lord, that you accepted us unconditionally, just like we need to do others. And Lord, we thank you again for this invitation time. I pray that you might just have your way and will accomplish now. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
388.
We're going to sing a few verses of song invitation. If you want to come pray for these names up here on these cards, you're welcome to do so. Maybe you just like to say, Lord, I'd like to do something. I want you to show me what to do. God's always looking for laborers. Whatever your need is, you just come pray as God's led you.
Next point of time. So pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
God bless.